Well, it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. Now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but stay over my blue suede shoe. Well, you can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. Well, do anything that you want to do, but honey, lay off of them shoes. And don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoes. Let's go, cat! Burn my house, steal my car, drink my liquor from an old fruit jar. Well, do anything that you wanna do, but honey, lay off of my shoes. And don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoe. Rock it! For the money, blue for the show, three to get ready. Now go, 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 but don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoe. Well, it's blue, blue, blue suede shoes. Blue, blue, blue suede shoes.
Yeah!
Blue, blue, blue suede shoes, baby. Blue, blue, blue suede shoes. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoe.
It was about a poor American who made it, the American story, and he met with his president. And I have to say, I'm a Kennedy guy, but Nixon got who Elvis was, and there was two guys who had been at the top of both their professions, and it was a rough time for both of them, and there was, I just felt that camaraderie. I felt more like I was at Graceland than the White House. I mean, Elvis was the guy in charge. You know, Nixon was running around doing what he said, which is amazing. Amazing. Elvis was in great shape. Elvis would not have gone to meet the President of the United States under any type of influence. And anybody that says different is a liar. I was the guy with him. I was the only person in the world that knew where Elvis was that weekend. I wasn't working for Elvis. I was a film editor at Paramount. Elvis had gotten upset down in Memphis because people were complaining about how much money he was spending. He got upset at his father. He got upset at Priscilla. And for the first time ever, he just went to the airport. I think he got on the first flight that was going anywhere. And he wound up in Washington. Didn't know what to do when he got there. Because, you know, here's a man that's had an entourage around him. He doesn't make plane reservations. He doesn't check himself into a hotel. He doesn't even make phone calls. So he goes back because he's got a credit card. I'm in bed sleep here in Culver City, and I get a call. It was, you know, 11, 12 o'clock, I guess. And I said, "Who is this?" And he said, "It's me." So I know it was Elvis. And he said, "Jerry, could you meet me at the airport?" And I said, "Sure." I said, "Who's with you?" And he said, "Nobody." And he said, "I don't want anybody in the world to know where I am." And so I called the limousine driver. Elvis is telling me what flight he's on. The whole thing, which I'd never seen him do, you know, all the years I worked with him and known him. And I picked him up probably about 1 or 2 a.m. in the morning at LAX. He had promised the stewardesses he would take them all home, So we took all the stewardesses home. Elvis was, I just never will forget the image though. He's walking off the plane. Now here's a guy that's never traveled by himself, and he has this little cardboard box. And I said, Elvis, what's that? And he looks at me, he goes, it's my luggage. You remember the little things they used to give you with toothpaste, a little wash rag and stuff, like you still get on international? That was Elvis's luggage. Elvis went to sleep. I couldn't go to sleep. I mean, nobody in the world knew where Elvis was. People probably thought he was kidnapped or God knows what. He got up the next afternoon. We just had a great conversation. We had coffee. We called up because I hadn't seen him in a couple of months. And toward that evening, he told me that he wanted to go back to Washington and he wanted me to come with him. And I said, I can't. I got to be at Paramount in the morning. I'll lose my job. And he said, you know, I'll get a Learjet and fly you back. And I said, well, it won't get me back any faster than a commercial plane. And he was so hard to say no to, you know. He was like, at that point, he goes, okay, I'll go by myself. I said, forget it. So I started making arrangements, calling the Washington Hotel, which he had told me he had checked into before, getting a car to pick us up. We had no money. He had a credit card. It was Sunday night. I got a check cashed at the Beverly Hilton Hotel for $500. We get on the plane for an all-nighter to go back to Washington. I've been up 2 days now. He meets a guy coming back from Vietnam. The servicemen were coming back. It was Christmas time. He gave him the whole $500. He said, Jerry, where's that money? I said, that's all we got. He said, you don't understand. This guy's going home. He gave him the whole $500. But on the plane, he asked me if I thought they would have any stationery. And that's when he started writing the letter to President Nixon. And he asked me to proofread it. And it was in his words. There was a lot of grammatical things that could have been better or whatever. We flew all night. We dropped it by the White House. It's like one of five letters he ever wrote in his life. It was about an American who was writing his president. And it was a very patriotic, beautiful letter. Elvis chose to be a nice guy. Elvis had all the qualities. He could have been a jerk. He was strong. He had the worst temper I've ever seen in a human being. But he chose to be a nice guy 99% of the time. You didn't want to be around him that other percentage point. I met him the same week he recorded his first record. And we started playing football in our local neighborhood. So that was my first impression of, believe me, I was there at the birth of rock and roll, and that was my first impression. He was like a cat on a hot tin roof, you know. You didn't go up and slap him on the back. Hey, buddy, I mean, you waited. You got his trust. He was very James Dean-ish in like a East of Eden mood. You know, he could have gone through people. He could have, and we were all poor guys in Memphis too. I mean, you know, he could have had the coolest friends in the world. He took us guys from down in Memphis, all of us poor, North Memphis, and he shared this life, you know. I mean, I see two of us, from my perspective, meeting the Beatles. I see just Elvis and I from playing football, where he couldn't get six people to play, so I got to play the young guy, to he and I in the Oval Room of the White House with President Nixon. I mean, you know, it's pretty much the American dream. And he took me along for that ride, which was really nice.
Well, it's blue suede shoes. Blue suede shoes.
Yeah!
Blue suede shoes, baby. Blue suede shoes.
Well, you can do anything, but they hope for my blue suede shoes.